started this right at 10:30 or a little bit before. two. Test, test, test.
Mic check, 1, 2. Mic check, check, check.
Better mic check.
Check, check, 1, 2. Check, 1, 2, check.
Were you there when he rose up from the causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord?
Better, brother.
Okay, folks, y'all come on in. Let's get started. Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see everybody this Easter morning. If you're visiting with us this morning, we're especially glad to have you this morning. In the bulletin that you were given when you came in, there's a form you are welcome to fill out. If you have any questions or any comments, we'd love to hear from you. You can drop it in that red feed bucket back there between the doors. That's where we put all of our communications with the front office. Whatever office it is. Y'all catch up in a little bit. I'm way ahead of you, I know. And the kids are going to sing this morning. We got a baptism this morning. We've got the Lord's Supper observance. We got a big day, so I better get on with it, I guess. I don't know why I feel compelled to look up the history on these hymns, but I do. So Easter Sunday in 1932. How many of you were here Easter Sunday in 1932? It'd be those of you that are 92. Those of you that were 92 were here. Alfred Ackley was a musician. He studied music in England, at Oxford probably, and in the U.S. He was a very talented songwriter and composer, but he was a preacher. So on Easter Sunday, 1932, Alfred was listening to the radio as he was getting ready to go preach at his church. He was listening to a radio preacher. In 1932, radio was the most popular means of hearing something like that. So the radio preacher said, "Good morning, friends. It's Easter Sunday morning, and it really doesn't make any difference to me if Christ arose or not. All that matters is that his truth is marching on." Alfred's wife claims that that upset Alfred so that he threw the radio across the room. He said, "That's a lie." He shouts as he hears the broadcast. Miss Ackley hears her and says, "Why are you shouting?" He said, "Did you hear what that good-for-nothing preacher said on the radio? This is the second time this week I've heard comments like this. I was witnessing to a Jewish college student, this is in Escondido, California, telling him about Jesus, and he asked me, why should I worship a dead Jew? And now this preacher said it doesn't matter to him that Jesus arose. He said, that's just the point. He's not dead. He arose." She said, "You better get ready for church. We're going to be late." So he gets to church, and he can't wait for the congregation to be over the announcements. He jumps up, and he lets them have it. He lays it on the line. And those that had guts enough went back that night for another round. I mean, he told them how the cow ate the cabbage. He got home that night, and she was fixing a little supper, and he was still pacing. She could hear him pacing back and forth in the living room. And she said, "Now what?" He said, I still haven't said all that I need to say about the resurrection." She said, "Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't you do what you do best? Why don't you go in there and write a song? And that way, the story will be told long after you're gone." So he goes in, and he writes the song. Then he goes to the piano, and he writes the score, the music. So that's how this second most popular Easter hymn came about. What did Paul Harvey say? It's the rest of the story. All right, we got a long way to go. Y'all stand, let's sing. I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the storms. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. Another is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, he lives.
lives.
He lives, Christ Jesus lives today.
He walks with me and talks with me a long life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead. And he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Thank you. Y'all can be seated. Children, we want to hear you sing. Come on. I'm sure there's a recording contract in here for somebody. You're singing over here. All right, you children, you go on to Sunday school. If you're ready, if you're visiting with us this morning, we'd welcome your children to go across to Sunday school. We do have a security team that goes across with them. They'll be in the building right next door. So they would be welcome to do that if they want to. Or they can stay in here with us. It's up to y'all. One other announcement, right quick. I think after the service, you parents, listen. Right after the service, they're going to hunt Easter eggs over there. So you parents today need to go over there and get them rather than them coming back over here. So you go over there and you help them with the hunting eggs and so forth, right? Is that what we needed to tell them, Bob? So y'all go get your children over there and help with them hunting eggs. They won't be coming back over here. Okay, Mike, I think we're ready for an Easter hallelujah.
Crown of thorns placed on his head, he knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father, did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his death. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He hung his head and prepared to die, lifted his face up to the sky, said, "I'm coming home now, Father, to you." The reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The body of our Lord said, "Truly, this was Jesus Christ, our Savior." He looked with fear upon his sword and turned and faced Christ our Lord, that fell to his knees and crying, "Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah." From his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, laid him down to rest inside the tomb. Holding his hands inside his feet, now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice anointed. Hallelujah. As they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, for Jesus Christ had risen. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
You may be seated. Rylan and family, come. If you want to come up here and stand with, I'll explain what we're doing here in just a minute. We need one other elder, if we could. Just stand right back here. Mike, if you'll be right here. Yep. And Rylan, why don't you step in? Turn right around, Rylan. This is my grandson, Rylan Miller. Now, I thought to myself, when the kids were all up here, do y'all remember, you that have been around here a while, when we had two or three kids and you couldn't hear them? And now God has given us, I don't know, a lot of kids, and I bless the Lord for that, and how they sang and how they worshiped, and even the little guys got in on the action. Well, I want to tell you, this is my son Michael. He's not as tall as he looks like. I'm just short. This is all our family. This is Michael's wife, Angela, and her mother. And Ashton is Rylan's sister most of the time. Here's the point. Angela's grandmother passed away, and so that funeral is going to be Tuesday. And it just so happens that they were back in Amarillo, and Rylan and Ashton got to come this time. So Rylan talked to me yesterday, said, "Can I be baptized tomorrow?" And let me explain the situation. And in 2017, Michael and Ashton came to visit with us for a week. And it was on a Wednesday night. Some of you were here and some of you might remember. Rylan came down the aisle with Glenda, his grandmother. Now, Rylan had been talking to Glenda about knowing Christ and wanting Christ in his life and wanting to be baptized. And he was disappointed that we couldn't baptize him that very night because we hadn't talked to Mom and Dad about that. But on Wednesday night, 2017, Rylan came down the aisle with Glenda. And he had prayed with Glenda, I think. Glenda, where are you? At the house. Am I right? So Rylan had prayed and invited Christ into his life. Now, I got to tell you one thing here. And I'll do it as quickly as I can. Michael and his family live in Galena, Illinois, and they've not been able to plug into a church there in Illinois. Michael told me yesterday that they are regular attenders of Crossroads Country Church by live stream. All right. And while I'm talking about that, Joe just told me that we've got another couple who go to church by live stream, but they're able to be here today. Robert and Mona Harris, where are you guys? There they are. Robert and Mona they've experienced some health issues. But Mona said, "I want to belong to that church," because they've been watching us and they felt like they were part of us. So actually, these are members from Claude. These are members from Galena, Illinois, who watch us. Now, Rylan wanted to be baptized. It was very important to him to follow the Lord in baptism. But we hadn't gotten it done, had we, until today. Rylan, let me ask you very quickly. Did you, when you prayed with your grandmother, with Mammy, did you ask Jesus to come into your heart?
I did.
And do you believe he did come into your life and heart? And we talked about yesterday what baptism signifies. Death to an old way of life, rising to walk a new way of life. And it's a picture. We're going to paint two pictures today in this church building. We're going to paint the picture of death, burial, and resurrection in the baptistry. We're going to paint the picture of the memorial service for Jesus. We remember his blood and his body, and we'll talk about those who should participate. I like participation in a church. And so you get people out of their seats, and you let them be part of the worship experience. It's important. So, Rylan, understanding exactly what we've talked about, and knowing that in the baptistry you're going to paint the picture of dying. When you prayed, that's when you died to an old way of life. Jesus came in, and he made you a brand new creature. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things are dead. Behold, all things have become new. So I am excited about that. But that happened 7 years ago, didn't it?
Yes, it did.
Is it still true?
Yep.
Still true. We're just a little tardy about getting you dunked. But that's our job today. So if you'll sit down, Michael, if you'll get on this side. There you are. Thank you, Jonathan. All right, Rylan. You've professed your faith in Christ today. Actually, it's something that happened 7 years ago. Something that happened a long time ago. Right there on the back seat, I'll remember forever that night on a Wednesday night when I gave the invitation. We don't normally do an invitation on Wednesday night, but I knew what had happened to you that day. But we didn't want to force you. We didn't want to push you into something you weren't ready to do. But you, Glenda said you got up all by yourself. You just moved. She came with you, but you made the move. So I appreciate that, and I'm thankful. And it's a joy to be able to baptize you as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so right now, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Congratulations, Rob.
We got a tail.
We love you anyway.
Because of all that we've been able to do today with the kids. Isn't that great? I just love that. And when Layton thought she wasn't going to get to go to Sunday school, she cried. A lot of kids cry when they have to go to Sunday school. So that's a joy. And it's a joy to now invite you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to be part of this memorial service. Now, here's what we believe as a church. We believe that people who participate in the Lord's Supper do not have to be members of this church. We believe that you should know Christ as your Savior. Otherwise, it doesn't mean anything. I'm going to give an invitation here in just a minute, and I'll invite you to come to Christ and pray with me. Pray and ask Jesus to come into your heart. Perhaps this is the day that God has prepared for you to come into your life. I told Rocky this morning, we talked, and the baptism wasn't planned until yesterday. And so Rocky and I kind of had to talk together and see how we would do this. And I said, I want to go from baptism right to the Lord's Supper. I want to just go right immediately, because those are the two ordinances of the local Baptist church. That is to profess your faith. And I talked to Ryland. There's no reason at all to come to church and crawl into a horse tank unless Jesus tells you to do it, and he did. And so it's a matter of obedience. It's a matter of saying to this congregation, I'm a child of God. I've been a child of God for 7 years, but I never followed the Lord until now. And then we go right into the Lord's Supper, where we honor Jesus for the sacrifice of his body and the sacrifice of his blood. But we also have other jobs to do, and one of them is to welcome new members, and our two newest members are Robert and Sheila Doloff. Did I do it right? Stand up if you would and sing your song. No. Rooster, would you go back and present this? Thank you, Rooster. I appreciate that. Now, our prayer list is, I'm going to give it to you. We're not going to do the prayer time exactly the way we usually do. We're going to do it as part of the Lord's Supper. Tex has asked us to pray for Mike Davis, heart surgery coming up. We're praying for Marguerite Groneman, for her new kidney to wake up. But I can't read the name of the person who requested prayer. Right back there. Megan. I'm sorry. It's very plain now. Tracy has asked that we pray for her dad, Alan. Alan Brees. She's praying that, and ask us to pray that the lung test he's going through will come back satisfactorily. Cody Gray asked that we pray for Dana and Pam Vellable. And she had back surgery.
Both of them.
That's right. Because I sat with them while Johnny was in surgery and talked to him. He had surgery, and then the next day she had surgery.
Yes, sir. He actually broke his back again Wednesday, and we'll have surgery again next week.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. If you didn't hear, he had surgery. That was Tuesday when I saw him. He broke his back again on Wednesday, and he's going to have surgery this next week. And then Cody Gray again has asked that we pray for Butch Whitaker, and that's Claude. Yeah, you tried to fool me, but you didn't. No. I knew that they called him Butch, but for Claude Whitaker, we've been praying for him as well. while you're being served either the bread or the cup, you may want to come with someone and just pray. I'll be here if you'd like to pray with me. We'll make sure that you're served before we participate and partake of the Lord's Supper. We'll make sure you're served as well, so don't worry about that. And so we'd invite you to do that at either time when you feel that it's appropriate. In my sermon that I had intended to preach, but I've changed my mind, you'll hear it probably next Sunday. In the study that I did during the week, the one thing that stood out to me was that Jesus is joy. Jesus is joy. And I got up this morning early thinking about the resurrection. And I thought when Rocky said what he did, I thought, Rocky, you've gone off the rails, buddy. Because I do think the resurrection makes a big difference. In fact, I think the resurrection makes all the difference. I believe that we should celebrate each Sunday the resurrection of Christ. Hope we do that today, because the resurrection of Christ ensures our own resurrection ultimately. I'd like to read to you the passage I was going to read, and we'll look at it. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20. If you're able, and you would be able to stand with us as we pay honor to the Word of God. I'm not going to ask this morning, but we didn't count, I don't imagine. Yes, we did. How many Bibles came to church today?
Oh, I didn't count the Bible.
There you are, Mrs. Statz. If you've got the Word of God with you, if you've got your Bible, hold it up. Hey, that looks pretty good. That looks pretty good. Thank you. Thank you. And we're not trying to shame anybody. Good night. We try to have a little fun in this church, but we sure don't try to embarrass anybody. I'm normally the guy that gets embarrassed. And before the service is over, you watch.
I would argue.
You think there's others? 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. That word means have died. That word fallen asleep means those people have died. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. But as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all will be made alive. But each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits. Afterward, at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, when he abolishes all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign until he puts all his enemies under his feet. And the last enemy to be abolished is death, for God has put everything under Jesus' feet. But when it says everything is put under him, it is obvious that he who puts everything under him is the exception, meaning that everything is under Jesus except God. And when everything is subjected to Christ, then the Son himself will also be subject to the one who subjected everything to him, so that God may be all in all. All in all. So that's our prayer today, that we can exalt the name of Jesus, that we can together join forces and worship as we take the Lord's Supper. What a marvelous, reverent time it is to be together in God's house, remembering Christ's death and remembering the fact that we are the body of Christ, that we are people who comprise the very body of Christ, that we're part and parcel of Him, and He's part of us. You may be seated. If I could ask our elders and the men who are going to serve the Lord's Supper with us to come. We take a bit of unleavened bread. And it's significant because it represents not only this body. Look around. And I'm serious about that. Look around for just a minute. If you don't get up and count or anything, but just look around and you'll see the body of Christ gathered together in this house. What an important thing that is. Listen, I've got to tell you one thing. Everybody needs a church. You need a place to worship. If it's on live stream, hallelujah. 30 or 40 people usually every Sunday worship by way of the live stream. That means that our body's bigger than it appears. We need, I will tell you this, this is no boast on my part, you need a preacher. You need a preacher. I look back over here, and I think of all that has gone on this week. I look in the back, I see Johnny Rodriguez, who had surgery. He did well, and he's giving his nurse fits. I wouldn't be surprised if he may be in the hospital again with a broken nose. I see John Allen over here, and his little daughter, Finley, had her palate repaired in Oklahoma City, and the doctor said, good as can be, better than expected. 1 year old. 1 year old. You need a preacher. You need a preacher. He won't always be there when you need him, but he'll try to be when you need him. You need a preacher. You need each other. I need you. I was over there this morning. We set this thing up this morning at 9:30 in the barn just so you might meet some new people that you hadn't met before. I saw people introducing themselves to each other. And I suspect there's people in this very building right now that don't know everybody who comes to church here. That wasn't a problem. Used to, when we started, that wasn't a problem. When you got 25 people, you can keep up. It's different now. We're a body, though. We are a body of Christ. And we worship together. We fellowship together. Just a minute, we're going to go hunt eggs together. I tell you, these kids, what a wonderful blessing they are. Wow, thank the Lord. Well, we are the body of Christ. Jonathan, where are you? Won't you pray for us, please?
Heavenly Father, we just come to you humbly this morning, just thankful that we have a body, Lord, that you gave up your body on that Friday yesterday. Just a few days ago, Lord, you gave up your body for us, Lord, that we may live forever, Lord, and you knew we needed you. We're so thankful for that, Lord. We're thankful for this church. We're thankful for the visitors that are here today, Lord. We're thankful for the children, Lord. It's such a blessing to be a part of that. just to hear little kids pray and know that they're talking to you, Lord, that's a blessing to me, and it's a blessing of this church, Lord. We're so thankful. We ask that you forgive us where we fail you. In your son's name we pray.
That reminds me, I was supposed to pray with the kids before they left. I was supposed to join hands, and I sure meant to do that. I love that. I'm sorry. I apologize to you all. That's all right. That's okay. Like to sing, sing. If you'd like to pray, come pray.
For thee, all the follies of sin.
But make sure that you're served.
My gracious Redeemer, my Savior, art thou. If ever I love, my Jesus is there. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. Love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus is I love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and say when the death do lies cold on my breath. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis thou. glory and endless delight. I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with a glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, tis thou.
I was about to forget my helpers. I got to tell you, as a congregation, you've never been blessed until you see these little kids join hands down here and hold hands with me and pray. And I mean not be forced to pray. You got to hold them back. You got to hold them back. And I'm so sorry that you missed that blessing on this Resurrection Sunday. Just hold that piece of bread up, if you would. Remember who you are. Remember whose you are. Remember that you're part and parcel of the body of Christ. I hear people all the time say, I don't fit in at that church. Well, I've never gone to a church that I didn't fit in. I really mean that. I've been to big churches. I've been to little churches. I've been to Filipino churches. I've been to Hispanic churches. I've been to African churches, and I felt right at home. Well, Jesus, as he took the bread and gave thanks, then handed it to his disciples, he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. The cup, representing the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. When Jesus came down to be baptized, John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God. I thought about on Friday, do you realize that, and maybe you do, maybe you don't, that at 3 o'clock in the afternoon in Jerusalem, when Jesus was dying on the cross, that is exactly the hour that they were sacrificing the lambs in the temple. 3 o'clock. In 2 days in Jerusalem, they sacrificed 250,000 lambs. The blood flowed freely under the altar, through a conduit out to the brook Kedron, and it flowed all the way to Bethlehem. And it was on that day, that very hour, that our sacrificial lamb was slain. So today we remember. How many times have I stood by the casket of someone for whom I preached a funeral service, and I've stood there at the head of the casket, and I've watched the family come by, and I've listened to them as they whispered terms of endearment to Dad or to Mom or to a child or to a brother or a sister. Well, that's kind of what we're doing today. I hope that we, before it's over, will be able to whisper some terms of endearment to the brother Jesus who died for us, gave his life that we might live, gave his life that we might go free. Joe?
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we humble ourselves before you, Lord. We just, so many times I can't find the right words to say to express my gratitude and my unworthiness for what you did for each and every one of us. Scripture says that each time we do this in remembrance of me. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to remember what you did, but also what you're going to do. You're going to come back.
Yes.
This cup represents the new covenant where we can come right before your throne. It's so easy. Help us to always remember that, that you're always there for us, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
Up Calvary's mountain, one dreadful night, walked Christ my Savior, weary and worn, facing for sins, death on the cross, that he might save. From endless loss, blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding. Sinners pleading, blind and unheeding, dying for me.
Perhaps you too would like to come.
Father, forgive me. Thus did he pray, even while his life flowed fast away, praying for sinners while in such woe. No one but Jesus ever loved so. Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding for sinners plead. how I love him, Savior and friend. How can my praises ever find thee? Through years unnumbered on heaven's shore, my tongue shall praise him forevermore. Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding, sinners pleading, blind and unhealed, dying for me.
Sing that chorus with us one more time.
Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding, for sinners pleading, blind and unhealed, dying for me.
The tomb is empty. You can go nowhere in this whole wide world and lay roses on the tomb of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't find it. We worship a risen Savior. And we have hope that someday, if we should die, that we will rise again. Jesus said to his disciples, as he took the cup and gave thanks, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." If you'll hand your cups down the aisle, or to the aisle, these men will come and retrieve them. Yeah.
Not after we sing?
They can get out this way. Parents, we're going to all stand and hold hands and sing "I'll Fly Away." But parents, why don't y'all don't go down the aisles, because people will be holding hands, but go right out this way. And go to the barn and be with your kids, because they're about to go hunt Easter eggs, okay? So, all right, stand everybody, hold hands, let's sing.
Somewhere